So as Joe said, I'm from IBM. I've actually been with IBM for 25 years, which is probably older than some of you folks are, so it's a bit shocking, but time flies when you get old. The master inventor thing, so this is actually a proper IBM title, it's not a made-up thing, honest. She says it on my business card, and if IBM lets me put it on my business card, it must be a real thing. Master inventor in IBM, there's about 10 or 15 of us down in our lab near Winchester. You have to have at least 12 patents. I've got 43, so it's okay. And it just keeps creeping up on you. And also, but the main thing is that you have to help other people find the innovation in their work. So it's a sort of peer election of people who are really helpful to other inventors, rather than just sitting in the corner inventing things like some people are who are not master inventors. We also have junior inventors, who are sort of the young Padawans who are on their way up through. You only have to have 5 patents to be a junior inventor. So, senior inventor, not junior inventor. Sounds too patronizing, doesn't it? Senior inventor, yeah. And I've been working the Internet of Things actually for 18 years, long before it was called the Internet of Things. We've been working in things like SCADA, which is supervisory control and data acquisition, which is monitoring oil and gas pipelines and remote assets, pervasive computing, ubiquitous computing, or Ubicomp, as the trendy academics used to call it. M2M, machine to machine. 7 years ago, IBM coined this term smarter planet, where we talked about instrumented, interconnected intelligence, which is a good way of looking at the world. But that name didn't stick either, and because IBM dreamed it up, and the rest of the world said, let's come up with something different. So Internet of Things is what kind of caught on, and that's what we are now in. But it's all the same stuff, and the stuff I've been doing for 18 years, we just keep crossing out the name, whatever name it is, and scribbling in the new name, and reusing the slides, which is handy. Now, today was going to be a real first. I'm very sorry to break this to you. It's not going to be a real first because I was going to present this presentation from a hydrogen fuel cell powered Raspberry Pi. But unfortunately, it broke. Got to the hotel, thought I'd just try before I go on stage, and it wouldn't fire up. So, I'm going to show you some slides about what the hydrogen fuel cell powered Raspberry Pi would have been. So you're just going to have to sort of wallow in disappointment at not having seen them. I'm really sorry about that. It's a pretty cool story anyway. So the idea of a hydrogen fuel cell is that, you know, when you were at school, you've got water and you put 2 electrodes in, you put electricity through them, you've got hydrogen bubbles on one electrode and oxygen bubbles on the other electrode. Well, that's how we make hydrogen. This machine here called an electrolyzer, which is about the size of a desktop coffee machine, that you put water in the top of it and turn it on, so it's a lot like an espresso machine, in fact, except you put these little cylinders in the front. They store hydrogen under pressure, it's about 10 bar, about 10 times the pressure of your car tires, and they store, one of those things stores enough hydrogen to power a Raspberry Pi for about 2 hours. It costs way less than a penny in electricity to make, so it's really, really cheap. So it's about the equivalent of 12 AA batteries, so almost nothing. Now, the cool thing is it only uses about a teaspoon of water. Remember Avogadro's constant, 6×10⁻²? That means there's an awful lot of H2 molecules in a teensy weensy amount of water, which means that you get loads of hydrogen for very little water. So that's how you make the hydrogen, and then the opposite reaction is in a fuel cell. And people just say fuel cell, but they actually mean hydrogen fuel cell. And that's where you do exact opposite reaction. You get hydrogen and oxygen, combine them with a catalyst, and you get back your teensy amount of water and a lot of electricity. So the electricity comes out through those red and black terminals. The fan in the top that keeps the suction of air going through it. So it takes oxygen from the air and hydrogen from the fuel from the cylinder, and then that makes electricity. And I bought a hydrogen fuel cell development kit, FCDK, which is really cool, and put it out on my kitchen table, as all inventors do, and annoyed my family by measuring all the things one weekend. And that quickly led to the first working prototype. Now, you have to have some electronics to manage the fuel cell. These things don't just work on their own. And the bit that came with the development kit didn't quite work properly. In fact, let's be honest, it destroyed the fuel cell. Ooh, ouch. That's 400 quid, we're not going to get back. These things are really expensive still, it's very early technology for hydrogen. So I had to build this additional board. This is where I can be certain that would have been, this is the very, you know, the world's only hydrogen fuel cell powered Raspberry Pi, because it needs that circuit board, which I built. And I haven't given it to anybody else yet. So that's that. Now, I used to carry this around with me to do presentations, but it was really so uncomfortable getting a cardboard box with all these tubes and screwdriver and wiring it all together just before a presentation. You know, I just couldn't cope with the stress. So Arcola Energy, which is the company that makes these fuel cell dev kits, who are up at in Arcola Theatre up in Kingston, Dalston, Kingston, near Hoxton, made me this lovely acrylic plinth for it, and even gave me a travelling case for it. That's the Raspberry Pi, and you all know what a Raspberry Pi is, don't you? Sometimes I get one or two little hands creep up to me, but I'm sure an educated audience knows what a Raspberry Pi is. And this is set up so it auto boots into my presentation in presentation mode. So you basically just plug this thing into a projector and it boots up a presentation about hydrogen fuel cells and hydrogen. So it's incredibly recursive because it's a presentation about hydrogen presented from a device that uses hydrogen. Really cool. Now, you may remember just before Christmas, the Pi Zero came out, teensy weensy little Raspberry Pi. Not only is it only £5, they gave away 10,000 of them on the front of a magazine. The first time in living history, in fact, not even living history, dead history as well, that a computer has been given away free on the front of a magazine. That, you know, all credit to Evan Upton for doing that. As soon as I saw that, and I actually snatched my copy of it from the Southampton Central Station, W.H. Smith, on the way through, I thought, Hi Pi Zero, we could make an even smaller hydrogen-powered Raspberry Pi. And I was actually on my way to the ThingMonk conference, which was actually held at the Arcola Theatre last December. And so I took it with me, and I challenged the guys at Arcola Energy, could you make a tiny little presentation device in time for my presentation the next day? So they worked feverishly night and day, a day and a night, and came up with this, still lashed together with a rubber band. This is a 1.5-watt fuel cell. The other one was a 12-watt fuel cell, by the way, so that big silver box could actually power three or four Raspberry Pis comfortably. Because the Pi Zero uses so little power, you can run it off this little one, and you can see how much smaller it is compared to the size of the stick. If you compare it with this one, it's much, much smaller. So I actually gave my presentation at ThingMonk from this. And that's pretty good, apart from the rubber band doesn't hold too well. So for Christmas, I got an iPod Touch, Apple device, and it came in this lovely acrylic box with nice rounded corners. I thought, you know what, that would almost fit in there. Probably not quite. So I gave it to the guys at Arcola and said, anything can do that. And they actually came up with this, which is what I was going to present from tonight. So this is the Hi-Pi Zero in an iPod Touch case. Your HDMI plugs in there. Your clicker goes in there. And your hydrogen goes in there. And it all works rather nicely, except today when it didn't work. So I'm really sorry about that. Now, it would be reasonable to ask why I was playing around with hydrogen. Yes, indeed. And the reason was because the last 4 years I've been working on an Innovate UK funded project to do with hydrogen. Working with other good people, see their names. And the idea was, so the exam question was, can you use hydrogen as a fuel for vehicles in a cost-effective way? So the idea was we're going to make a massive, great electrolyzer and use it to make hydrogen to power hydrogen-powered cars. You've all got a hydrogen-powered car, haven't you? No, not yet, but you will have, I'm sure. And then what do the economics of that work out? In other words, are people prepared to pay enough per mile for that hydrogen service to pay for the cost of running the electrolyzer? And that was the project. So we built a massive, great electrolyzer. It comes from ITM Power Up in Sheffield, makes solid great electrolyzers. This is one the size of a shipping container. That's what the inside of an electrolyzer looks like. Don't ask what the bits do, but it's all very narrow piping. It's all done at about 350 bar, so it's ludicrously high pressure. You really don't want to be in front of one of those things when it goes pop. And we store it under pressure in those green tanks. Those are 350 bar, are they? Yeah, 350 and 450 bar tanks. And the refueling station looks a lot like a petrol station. So it's got a nozzle and a thing. You put in your details, confirm you've done the safety briefing. You plug it into your car, that's where the similarity ends. At that point, it forms a vacuum and then transfers hydrogen under pressure into the tank of your car. And when it's finished, you get a little bill, just pay at the pump at Sainsbury's, and you pay with your credit card, and you drive off in your hydrogen-powered car. What does a hydrogen-powered car look like, I hear you ask? Well, there's two sorts. There's HICE, hydrogen internal combustion engine. This is where, if you know what you're doing, you can get a petrol engine and convert it to run on hydrogen. And this company called Revolve does that to transit vans. So you're basically driving along on petrol, you flip a switch on the dashboard, there's a sort of puff of something out the back, and at that point you're running on hydrogen, and it's actually steam coming out the back, which is like a steam engine. So that's you're completely clean from that point on in terms of carbon. And then the other one is an FCEV, a fuel cell electric vehicle. This is a normal electric vehicle, so it's got batteries to make the turn electric motors to make the wheels go around. But the batteries are recharged from a fuel cell. So there's a tank of hydrogen in the boot and a fuel cell, about a 4 kilowatt fuel cell, which is about the size of a car radiator, this sort of size, and that charges up the batteries. Now, the reason you can't run it just on a fuel cell is that when you accelerate away from the traffic lights, you need the extra oomph that only batteries can give you. So you basically trickle charge the batteries using the fuel cell. And they work nicely. That's a Hyundai one. They're about 38 grand. Still quite expensive, but they're very, very comfortable to drive. This is a micro cab, which is a project done by the advanced manufacturing folks up in near Warwick. And it's basically a smart car, so a two-person vehicle. It's an electric vehicle, and they retrofit them with fuel cells to make them into fuel cell electric vehicles. And so that was the project was a mixture of those things. We also made a hydrogen-powered boat. This was made at Ventnor on the Isle of Wight, from where I live, very conveniently. And this one was before they put the tanks in. So the tanks actually go down the middle, and then there's two outboard motors, one of which was converted to run hydrogen. So it's an HICE outboard motor, which is the world's first. It definitely invalidated the warranty. Honda were not impressed when we tried to call them up about it. You've done a mark to it! Yes, we did. So it, of course, gave the MCA, Marine Coast Guard Authority, a bit of a problem because they couldn't certify it as safe because they had nothing to compare it with in the world. They go, well, we take your word for it that it's safe, but that's not how our certification process works. So we're actually educating the MCA on each little tiny bit of it so they can work towards giving it safety certification so they can actually use this boat for anything other than just people like us driving around in it for research purposes. They want to use it as a public boat. So that's pretty cool. Just about 4 weeks ago, the hydrogen powered boat did a circumnavigation of the Isle of Wight. It did the RTI, ran the island race, it ran the Isle of Wight, powered by completely by hydrogen. They had the other motor, so basically they weren't using the other motor. It was there in case the hydrogen ran out and they were stranded halfway around. But actually, they got back with just under half a tank of hydrogen left, so they could have almost got round again had they been so inclined. They weren't. It takes about 4 hours to get round, so they're not in the mood to do that. But that was pretty good. They had a drone flying around it, so we've got some epic, and I mean epic, footage of this thing going past the needles and otherwise it's very, very beautiful. And at the same time, we got the micro cab, and we drove that round the road around the outside of the Isle of Wight, 50 mile journey around the outside of the Isle of Wight. The hardest bit was getting out of Ventnor, because it was a massive great hill. And they had to actually reprogram the computer in the microcab to get it up the hill because it's in sort of economy mode. There's no way to go up the hill in economy mode, so they had to put it into full blast mode so it could take a run at it and get it up the hill. From that point on, it was fine, but just county press were there, Saturday were there, reporters were there, cameras were there, and this thing wouldn't go up the hill. This guy sitting there with his laptop reprogramming the parameters. All good fun. Anyway, so, and they actually called in a whole load of schools on the way around to do show and tell for the children, which is good. So that's hydrogen. Any questions about hydrogen? Yeah, you can have a discussion about hydrogen later. Right. So the reason we're really here is to hear about Internet of Things. That was a minor diversion, but I guess to admit quite an interesting one. So I'm going to talk about a sort of journey from home experimentation through to a sort of commercial service offering, just to show how sort of Internet of Things ideas evolve over a number of years and how some of my wacky ideas turn into slightly more serious ideas. So as I mentioned, I started working in the Internet of Things 18 years ago. I designed a messaging protocol called MQTT, which is extremely popular now in the Internet of Things world. It was declared, approved as an ISO standard just 2 weeks ago, 20922, if you want to Google it. So that's quite the end of the long journey. But at that time, I was experimenting with this new messaging protocol for things connecting to the Internet. And I very literally took my work home with me and turned my house into a living laboratory, much to the annoyance of my family. I just wanted to wire up sensors really to get some data. And at the time, I wasn't really sure what to do. A few magnetic switches on doors and windows, temperature sensors, some usual sort of things. And I thought I could hit on this idea of measuring the how much power the house was using by using a current clamp around the big fat wire coming into the house, digitizing that signal and publishing it to the internet using MQTT. And at the time, it was just an interesting number, but it became increasingly obsessed then with my carbon footprint and energy use, and became a whole sort of way of life for me to reduce my energy footprint. So that became very interesting as well. And I actually spent 5 years as an energy consultant for IBM on the basis of the knowledge I gained from this. So this is live data on the internet. And if you're a sad geek like me, you can interpret this. That up and down thing is the fridge, that's the shower, those two are the kettle, that double spike there is the dishwasher. Here we've got all sorts of things happening. And each different appliance has its own unique fingerprint, so you can identify what's happening mostly. I mean, when there's loads of stuff on, it's really hard to disambiguate it, but that's obviously the shower because at 6 o'clock in the morning, what's going to be pulling 8 kilowatts are in the shower. Now, my family, much to my slight concern, weren't as into this as I was. Yeah, they weren't going to pull up a browser and look at the graph and say, oh, we had a cup of tea then. It's sad, really, because, I mean, to me, they're three-quarters of the problem when it comes to the energy use of the house. I mean, much as I love them, they are three-quarters of the problem. So I designed this, I think, an ambient orb. It's a glass ball about so big with red, green, and blue LEDs inside that can glow in any color combination. And that subscribes to the energy usage of the house. So it's green when it's low, amber in the middle, and when it's high, it's red and flashes when it's really, really high. And this idea of an ambient device is quite a powerful one. There's a guy called Chris Rose, who was at MIT Media Lab in the mid-90s, just about the time I was hanging out there for a bit. And he actually came up with this idea. And he's written a book called Enchanted Objects, and it's well worth reading. Not on commission, it's just well worth reading. And he talks about how Internet things about imbuing objects with enchantment. So an example is that he sells through ambientdevices.com an internet-connected umbrella. And it's a normal umbrella, it's got like a little sort of glass dome on the end of it. It's multifaceted like a big diamond. And you put it in the umbrella stand by your door. As you go out to work in the morning, if it's flashing red, you take it with you because it's going to rain today. Simple as that. If it's not flashing, you leave it there because it's not going to rain today. And that, so you've enchanted the umbrella with this ability to know where to go online to the Weather Channel and find out if it's going to rain where you work, or between your house and where you work. And that's really useful. So this idea of sort of glanceable displays or ambient devices is very interesting to me. I'm particularly fond of them, as for these little orb things, various things. But you sometimes forget which one shows you which. I have to put little labels next to them to remind me. So in fact, we did a project when the Raspberry Pi came along, Raspberry Pi and a ping pong ball. So you can get a really, really bright, brighter than the sun, multiple LED from an LED ball that plugs onto the Raspberry Pi, and taking the data from an energy monitor, parsing it, using some other wonderful software called Node-RED. You can then make this do the red, amber, green thing. And this was done as a classroom experiment with Tech Future Classroom. So there's an online course on how to do this, the shopping list and everything, so the children can recreate it in the classroom. Learn about energy usage, learn about programming. What a heady combination. Not content with monitoring the whole house, I thought we wanted to drill down to find out what different things we're using. So I started putting energy clamps on every bit of wire I could find, using the simple IAMs, individual appliance monitors that plug into the socket, and you plug your TV or washing machine or whatever into the back of it. And that gave me more insight into what different things in the house were using. And that enabled me to write an application called the Power Pi, where the whole house energy uses a circle, and then it pulls out the heaviest hitting things over time that it can find as slices of the pie. So for example, the biggest shock I got was from the kitchen lights. 8% of my electricity bill is from the kitchen lights. We've got these banks of halogen spotlights. They've been bright. We used to just leave them on most of the time. That's costing me £148 a year to light my kitchen. Ouch. So as soon as I realized that, I first instituted a very low-tech solution. Last person out turns the lights off. Now, my parents used to tell me to do that when I lived at home. I could never work out why, but I can see exactly why. So that saved us quite a bit of money. But then, of course, this gave me this of the financial information to do the, you know, the ROI calculation with the LED lighting. LED bulbs are fantastic. If you're not using LED bulbs in your house, go home and do it now. They use 1/10 the power of the equivalent incandescent bulb. Yeah, there's your LED. Which means basically you're saving 90% of the money you would have been saving. So the ROI, at the time I did this, LED bulbs that were non-standard were very expensive. It cost me about £300 to replace all these bulbs. But because I was spending £148 a year on electricity, I was going to pay back within less than 2 years. And indeed it did about 5 years ago. So that's really good. So definitely switch to LED lighting. My house is also on Twitter. If you Google for the house that tweets, there are two. There's mine on the Isle of Wight, and there's another one owned by Tom Coates in San Francisco. His, by his own admission, is a knockoff of mine, so don't confuse the two. His is slightly more chatty, I must admit. It says things like, Tom seems to have gone out and left the lights on. I'll turn them off for him, shall I? Whereas mine just says things like, outside lights turned on, the phone is ringing. So when the phone rings, it picks up the caller ID off the line, looks up the number in a little database to see who it is, then it DMs me on Twitter to tell me who's calling. So I say, oh, Jim just called your house. So I phone Jim back and say, oh, you called. Yeah, but you're out. I know, my house just told me. Woo, that really freaks him out. And there's various other stuff there, like every £5 worth of electricity use through the month, it tweets me about that. So mixed in with all the tweets from my other friends, I'm getting tweets from my house just to tell me what's happening from an energy point of view, and water usage, and some security stuff. And also didn't tweet to say if the front door is wide open, bit of a giveaway. It has a code. It has a coded way of telling me that, so a little message comes up if the front door's been open for more than 10 minutes. And I just find it really useful. When we first did this, it was a little while ago now, it was in 2009, in fact, Rory Caston-Jones, name drop, came to my house, to film for the BBC News. And when it was on the BBC News, the account for this was open and public, so anybody could join. And after a week, there were 650 people following my house. Back at the time, I only had 600 people following me. So there were more people following my house than following me. That was not a good thing. So I tweeted on here to say, why are you all so interested in my house? And people go, oh, because your house is so interesting. It's so much more interesting than all my friends. Right, okay. Step away quietly. So I threw them all off and made it a private account, because, you know, there's quite a lot of insight into what me and my family are doing from this Twitter account. So I didn't want random people who think a house is more interesting than their friends following my house. And now it's just a sort of playground for a few people follow it just for sort of interesting educational reasons, but it's mostly just a playground for me to play around with new ways of combining data from different sensors to give more insight into what's happening. If windows open and heating's on, bad combination. That's quite fun. As well as monitoring things, I talk about monitoring, I also control things as well. So I've got a rather ancient home automation system called X10 that allows you to send signals around the mains wiring to turn various things on and off. So as an example, my heated towel rail in the bathroom is actually the smartest heated towel rail in the world. It can look into my diary, find out when my first meeting is, count back the right amount of time to know when I'll be getting up and make sure the bathroom is just the right warm, fluffy towels and so on. When I get up, if it's the weekend, it does it a bit later. If it's a bank holiday, it does it a bit later. If I'm away on business, it's not con at all. We've got two bathrooms again, just the family uses the bathroom. All right, your poor family. So that's pretty cool. And the other thing that's quite cool is the patio lights here. So when the ISS flies over, the International Space Station, you've got an MQTT feed, so wherever you are on the planet, it buzzes you to tell you when it's going over. It actually flashes its lights. So if somebody's looking down from the ISS, they're able to see the lights flashing. And the idea is that people all around the world should do that, so that as it goes around, they see people flashing up at it, so waving at the ISS. It's quite a nice little thing. Well, we like it anyway. Welcome to my world, sorry. At Christmas, we can text the reindeer, so you can text reindeer on to my house, and the Christmas lights come on. Now, the reason for showing you this is not just because it's cool, obviously it is, but more that if you've got the sort of infrastructure in place to do sort of home automation, sort of MQTT, Node-RED, Mosquito, you know, Raspberry Pi, usual suspects, then adding this kind of application becomes a small delta. So if you gave me a phone and some Christmas lights and said join them together, I go, oh man, it can take me ages. Whereas this was only took me half an hour, it's really cool. Most of that half hour was actually wiring up the waterproof connector there, because we already had an SMS to MQTT gateway and an MQTT to X10 gateway, so just to join those two things together to make this solution work. And if you weren't having doubts about my sanity already, this would tip you over the edge. Every inventor has to invent a better mousetrap. This is my better mousetrap. This is an example of remote asset monitoring. So this is essentially, okay, mousetrap 101. Once you've caught a mouse, you don't catch any more mice until you reset it. Okay, fundamental problem of mousetraps. So you need to know as quickly as possible that you've caught a mouse in order to reset it to catch the next one. So this is a remote monitoring system. This little computer here monitors up to 8 mousetraps simultaneously in the attic. The new version uses Zigbee and stuff. It's all wireless, but this is more than 10 years old now. So it's a closed circuit. When the mousetrap triggers, it breaks the circuit. That's gets detected by this little box. It sends out a message called a mouse event. Awesome geeky laughter, thank you very much. And then it sends off an MQTT message. And this just shows how old it is. This is my phone. This is an N95, not the N95. This little smiley mouse here saying ready for action turns into a gravestone. It says, mousetrap in the study went off or something like that. So I get an alert saying the mousetrap's gone off. My son has a little dashboard on his computer in the corner of the screen, so if I'm not at home, he knows how many bits of cheese and the body bags to take upstairs to sort things out. And this has been in production for nearly 10 years, over 10 years, in fact, and it's very effective. Interestingly, the mice only come in the autumn, and one year, when I came to sort of set it all up for the autumn, I discovered that the mice had actually attacked the computer that controls it, which would have chewed away the stuff. There's a whole real sort of Douglas Adams thing going on here, that maybe the mice aren't quite as stupid as they look, but are they factory of projection to our dimension of vast type of undimensional beings? And they'd worked out that this is a box that was causing their downfall, so they'd have ganged up on it and attacked it. Which is a bit spooky, a bit, so. And you'd think that would be the end of it, but no. Rentokil actually came to one of my seminars when I was presenting this, and at the next one, they came along with their radar system, the rodent activated detection and riddance system, which is only a prototype, you can tell, because that's definitely a potato with a piece of string sticking out of it. But the idea is that the mouse goes in through the gate, it breaks an infrared beam, a little door slides across to trap it. This is a tank of CO2, it releases the valve on the CO2, floods this chamber, and apparently, RSPCA compatible, this is the safest, the kindest way of killing a mouse, is to flood it with CO2. Heart rate goes faster and faster and faster and faster, and goes, has a heart attack and dies. It then sends out an SMS signal to Rentokil to say, you caught a moggy. Now, imagine if you're the customer, you get instant service. They come straight to your house within minutes to take away the stiff and just reset it again for the next time. So they're giving you a much better service. Rentokil is also not having to drive around everybody's house every week, wasting all that diesel, to check whether they've caught anything or not. So they're delivering the same service, kind of better service, for lower cost. And that really is a sort of quintessential element of the Internet of Things, is that you can deliver a better service at lower cost thanks to the IoT. That's gone red, does that mean? Right, that led to experimentation at home, led to an interesting thing called Kale Community Project, which was in the village of Kale, in the Isle of Wight, imaginatively named. And this was to monitor energy usage in social housing. And the people who lived in these houses were not particularly well off. A lot of them were in what's called energy poverty, which means they're spending more than 10% of their household income on energy. There's no gas on this side of the island, it's all electricity, so they had night storage heat and stuff like that. So they retrofitted the houses with air source heat pumps, solar panels, double glazing, and off insulation. And the sort of the hypothesis was, will these people learn new ways of using energy, things like washing machine, tumble drying, or the big hitters, to take advantage of the energy from the solar panels, or will they still do it in the evening and therefore have to buy the electricity off the grid? And we were working with Surrey University to do this. So they were doing the qualitative side. They were interviewing the residents to find out what they thought they were doing differently, but we didn't have a quantitative way of finding what they were actually doing. So they said, oh, you should go and talk to Andy. He lives just around the corner, and he does this kind of energy monitoring stuff. We saw it on the telly. And so we put in a kit of stuff into each house, monitoring solar panel use, energy use, and individual appliance monitors. And we actually hacked is probably the wrong word, but we worked with Current Cost to update their bridge thing, which is actually an Arduino, to talk MQTT. so it actually sends it back to IBM's IoT platform, and then we made a big anonymized database so that Surrey University researchers could have access to the data, and we built a portal so that the residents could log in and see their own energy use. And so, and these are the individual appliances, and then we had some green energy assessors who kind of sit down with you and go through this to help understand if there are any anomalies, and to help you understand that the best time to run the washing machine is when the sun's shining in the middle of the day, because then it's free. But if you run the washing machine and the tumble dryer at the same time, only one of those is free, but if you run them one after the other, they're both free if the sun's still shining. So just little things like that, these little memes would travel around the estate and people would learn. And the net effect of this was that people did have more money in their pocket. Rent arrears for the estate went down to nothing, like nobody's in arrears for their rent. Vandalism in the estate went right down as well, which is interesting. So people sort of had a bit more respect for the property because people were giving some attention to it. It was a sort of forethorn effect thing. But anyway, I'm leaving that for the psychologist at Surrey University. I'm just an engineer. But what this did do for me was to give me an unhealthy interest in fridges and freezers. Now, fridges and freezers are normally off until they get too warm, then they turn on, and then they run a compressor, which chills the air and makes it get cold again. And then when it's cold enough, they turn off, and they just keep doing that over and over again. So they're off mostly, on for a bit, and then they chill down, and then they turn off again, and repeat, rinse, repeat. Now this is a new fridge, and the thing called the duty cycle, which is how much they're on compared to how much they're off, is kind of a good situation. As they get older, the compressors get less efficient, the seals around the door start to go, and they tend to be on a bit more often in order to keep the temperature down, keep the food safe. When they get towards the end of their life, they're actually on more than they're off. This one's costing about £150 a year to run. Now, you can go down Currys and buy a new one for about £90, so you know that's costing more in a year to run than would you buy a new one. So it would be well worth them going out to buy a new one. The ROI is about 9 months. The question is, do you know this is happening? So we've set up some monitoring stuff using some analytics on the waveforms coming off the Chail project to actually spot when fridges are getting to that sorry state and sending out emails to say you'd be better off buying a new fridge. Now, if you were a fridge salesman, a salesperson, you'd love to know that because you can go and doorstep someone and say, look, special offer this week only, £80 to you. And by the way, I know that's going to pay for itself in 6 months because here's the data to prove it. So there's a whole new business model being enabled by, again, Internet of Things. So one thing we learned from this project and the stuff I've done at home was that you get an awful lot of insight into what's happening in someone's house based on this energy. So you could say it's quite intrusive, or you could say it's really interesting, or you could say, well, actually, we could turn that to good. So just hold that thought for a minute. I will just mention, different slide. So this is, so what it's led to was a project that Current Cost, the company that makes these little energy monitors, and IBM did together called Current Care. You can go to currentcare.uk.com, you can see all about it. Essentially, this is using data from energy use and other sensors to keep an eye on people in their homes. And the idea is this with elderly people or vulnerable people or people who live in sheltered housing schemes or whatever. Would benefit from this, so somebody somewhere can tell if they're up and about and if they're okay. Another interesting use case is, as predicted by Joe, is the chairman of Current Cost, Martin Dix, his father's got early stage dementia, and they're really worried about him getting up in the middle of the night confused and going out the front door and wandering out into the road. You know, there's a real risk of that. So he's got a door sensor with a magnetic switch on the door, and we've got a rule set up in our system which says if the front door opens between midnight and 5 a.m., send a text to the neighbor who said they keep an eye open for him, turn him around, pop him back into bed, everything okay. So the idea is you monitor various things in the house, and you have, rather than sitting watching the graphs, which would be rather tedious, you have the computer sitting watching the graphs, and if certain things happen or don't happen by a certain time, you send out an alert. Now, what kind of started this all off was kettles. Everybody in the UK, without fail, 100.0%, has a cup of tea first thing in the morning, don't you all? Yes. So if you haven't had a cup of tea by about 10 o'clock, then that's probably a bad sign. So if my mother-in-law, who lives on her own, hasn't had a cup of tea by 10 o'clock, she's, you know, genuinely, there's probably something wrong with her. She, you know, might be ill or fallen or something. So I've got a system which monitors the energy usage of her kettle, and if it gets to 10 o'clock and she has had a cup of tea, she goes, okay, no problem. If it gets to 10 o'clock and she hasn't had a cup of tea, I get an SMS saying June's not up yet. And I give her a call and say, you okay? She says, oh, yeah, she's been out feeding the animals. Okay, it's fine. If she wasn't okay or we didn't answer the phone, we'd be around there like a shot to check she's at the sort of ramp. So that gives us peace of mind that she's okay, but also gives her peace of mind because she said to us when we installed it, she's really worried that if she did have a fall or died or something, then her animals wouldn't be opened, you know, the dogs wouldn't be let out and the chickens wouldn't be let out and so on. So at least somebody would go around and look after them rather than starving to death because she wasn't there to do it. So peace of mind from two sides. And my parents actually use this as well. They're still perfectly fit and able and are off on holiday all the time, but they actually use the current care system to monitor their own house while they're away, make sure that the person who comes in to sort out the post and do the greenhouse and stuff has actually been, because they get little alerts saying greenhouse doors open or something like that, and they can check everything's okay. If something unexpected happens, like water sensor triggers or the fridge dies, this actually happened one time, the fridge died while they were on holiday, and they said, when we get back, all of our frozen stuff will be all over the floor. And indeed it was. There's nothing they could do about it, but at least they knew it was going to happen. So we have all these different sensors that link in to the energy monitors, which actually energy monitors is quite a useful thing, as you've kind of gathered, the individual client monitors. But we've got a toilet flush sensor. If you don't have a cup of tea, you'll definitely go to the toilet. So this is a little float switch in the system that sends out a message when you flush the toilet. The window and door magnetic catches, temperature sensor, so if the temperature drops below a certain temperature in the sitting room, send that message. There's a motion detector, so you can make a PIR sensor, so if there's motion in the room or not motion in the room, you could trigger on that. And a pressure mat, which is used for various things, but we tend to use it as a falling out of bed detector. So you put it by the bed, and if somebody falls on it in the middle of the night, it triggers a message. And that's the system, really, and it's the data sent over a radio link into the gateway, and then use MQTT into the IBM Watson IoT platform, into our Bluemix platform, into Node Red, and that's where the rules are implemented. And it sends out SMSs through Twilio, which is one of the services in Bluemix, to alert you to either SMS or email when one of the rules is triggered. And that's available as a service through Current Care. And pretty good, really. It actually makes you feel you're doing something good with the internet thing, you know, something good for the world. You get a nice warm feeling inside. And almost everybody you talk to goes, oh, yeah, I've got an aging parent or aunt or relative or somebody. We've also got a lot of interest from landlords because they can also help them monitor the fabric of their own houses for temperature and humidity and boilers starting to fail and stuff like that. So, a number of different constituencies using the same sensors for different sort of insights. Some of the rules we do, dashboard, you can configure the rules for each thing. So like if the toilet hasn't flushed by 10 a.m., then send an SMS to this person. I will just mention the IBM Watson IoT platform, so IBM's paying me to be here. If you want to connect your things to the internet, IBM, amongst other people, have a platform for doing it. You can connect your things, process the data, use analytics. What's becoming really apparent is that it's not the data itself or even the things, it's what you do with the data that's important, okay? So it's the analytics layer doing stuff with the data, turn it into actionable insights, that's the powerful part of it. And I think what we're going to see is that the connection will become sort of table stakes, just getting connected. And pretty much everyone's using MQTT anyway, so that's not a differentiator. So Microsoft, Amazon, and IBM, and a whole load of other smaller players are using MQTT as their connectivity protocol into the platform, and then it's what you do with that data and the processing that's the clever bit. So we flow it into Bluemix, and we've got all the IBM Watson analytics to do stuff with the data to understand what's going on. And finally, this is my Internet of Things for Transport example. Living on the Isle of Wight, as I do down here, I come to work by ferry from the Red Jet from Cowes to Southampton. And Red Funnel that runs the Red Jets, on particular, in the past, haven't been particularly good at telling people, us, the commuters, when the ferries weren't running. It's a foggy morning, a stormy night or something. The ferries might not be running, and you wouldn't know. So you rock up at the ferry port, no ferries. Only we could have known. They did set up this recorded hotline so that if you phoned it and said, all the ferries are running on time. Now, that message was recorded at 5 o'clock the night before when the guy went home. Any time between then and when he showed up the next morning, anything would happen. So actually, the ferries might not be running, even though the message said they were, so that was pretty useless. And I was sitting there one day, drumming my fingers in frustration because there's no ferries, thinking, Internet of Things, instrumented internet intelligence. If only we could get location data from the ferries, because they have this really cool IoT thing. And it turned out that this is really the bit I needed was to find out GPS trackers on the boats. Now, I knew Red Funnel wouldn't let me do that, so I'm a bit precious about them. But it turns out that's already been done for me by this thing called AIS, Automatic Identification System, which all the big boats have is a GPS receiver and a radio beacon that transmits out in a 50-mile radius the name of the boat, the speed, the direction, and the GPS coordinates. Very handy if you happen to receive it. Now, there's a lovely crowdsourced network called ShipPlotter, where loads of people receive that data, feed it into a central database. You can now go to anywhere on the planet, give it a geo-rectangle, and get details of all the boats that are in that section. So I wrote a little Perl script sitting, this shows how long ago it was, sitting in my car by the ferry with my 3G GPRS dongle plugged into the side, pulled down this XML file of all the ferry positions, all the boats, stripped out the ferries by name, Regjet 3, Regjet 4, Lady Pamela, Whitelight. You live in the Isle of Wight, you get to know all the ferries by name, believe me. And then I used geofencing, so you put a circle around each ferry port, and as the GPS coordinates go into that circle, you know, the boat's leaving or arriving at the ferry port, a bit of logic, you can work out which direction it's going. That sends a message out, and that message gets sent to Twitter. So each of the ferry routes has its own Twitter feed. If you're on Twitter, you can go to @redjets or @red_ferries and see the live data. So things like Regjet 3 leaving West Cowes, Regjet 1's arriving Southampton, and the time, so you can see if they're running on time or not. Or not at all. Now, I did this completely independently of the ferry company. Okay, I did email them a couple of times to say, ooh, who did the twittering red jets? That's really cool. Hoping they'd write back and go, we don't know. I could go, it was me. They just ignored my email. So, well, this was solving a real problem for me. You know, as a commuter, I could bring this up on my phone and see if the ferries were running. Hundreds of people were using this every day to plan their journeys. Commercial trucks were using it to plan their journeys. So I was getting all the kudos I wanted from, you know, bathing the glory of the people loving my Twitter feed. This was running on a precursor to the Raspberry Pi in my study at home, so using data from goodness knows where on the internet. It was a complete unofficial service, but hey, it worked. Anyway, one day, it was April 1st, I remember it well, I was looking at some ferry times for a friend, and here on the Red Funnel website, it said, current live positions, Regjet 4 is leaving West Cowes, Regjet 3 is arriving Southampton. I thought, ooh, that's novel. They're doing the same thing as me. I wonder where they're getting their data from. So I moused over it, and that actually turned into a link, and I clicked through it, and it went to my Twitter page. So what they were doing was they're pulling an RSS feed off Twitter and merging it live into their website, which is pretty cool, but they hadn't asked me or told me, so I was a bit miffed. So because it was April the 1st, and because I could, I thought I'd play a little trick on them. So I... well, it hung in the balance, I must admit. So I logged into Twitter and put, Regjet 4's arrived in Milton Keynes. And when I give this presentation to the country, I have to explain, and that is not by the sea. You can't get there by ferry, okay? I did put April Fool on the end of it. But for the next hour, as this worked its way down the list, that was the official status of Regjet 4 on the Red Funnel website, which I thought was hysterical. So we screen grabbed it and blogged it and tweeted it and got on local radio. And it was talk of the town for about a couple of hours. Eventually, I kind of felt a bit guilty about it. And I phoned Red Funnel and said, have you seen where Regjet 4 is? Yes, we've just noticed. I think we should meet. I think we should. And we met the next morning, and I was expecting to get into trouble for sort of defacing their website. But actually, they said, look, this is fantastic. We've been meaning to get into social media. We haven't quite got the hang of it. To be honest, we didn't know how to contact you. Okay. On the top of the Twitter feed, it says, Regjet by @AndySC. So they could have tweeted me, okay? But they didn't realize that. This just shows how little understanding of social media they had at that time. Anyway, so they said, this is fantastic. Can we buy it, please? So this is the easiest sale in IBM's history. They bought this. This is now running in their data center in Southampton. Actually, their DR site is a Raspberry Pi in my study at home. They think they're using the whole IBM disaster recovery thing, but it's just a Raspberry Pi. Bring Node Red. Yeah, it would. But the you're filming this, aren't you? Oh, whatever. But they stand up at conferences and say, "Oh, okay." Oh, but they stand up at conferences and say how wonderful the Internet of Things is and how smarter transport is sort of changing their business, and it has changed their business. And they've really gone for this big time. They've got websites, you know, mobile websites, shows you where all the ferries are. There's little screens up in the terminal showing you where the boats are. The staff actually know where the ferries are. They say, "Oh, the ferry will be here in 10 minutes." Go, "Yeah, we know." "Oh, you checked on Twitter as well." "Yes." So they're all using this, which is pretty cool. And more than anything, it's actually given them a channel to communicate with us, the commuters. So you can actually tweet at Red Funnel now and say, "When's the last ferry tonight?" Or, "Do you think these winds will cause disruption?" Or, "Is it going to be foggy tomorrow?" And they'll tweet you back, or, "How much is the day return?" They'll answer questions live on Twitter, which is fantastic. But the only reason they do that is because this kind of stimulated the idea. So this is essentially, you could say it's a new business model, but it's definitely a competitive advantage that Red Funnel's gained over Whitelink through engaging on social media triggered by the activity around this automated feed. So that's pretty cool. Right, that's me and the set of things. Thank you very much.
Great. I didn't even have to. That was just timed perfectly. And just as the food came out, it's almost like you've embedded something.